You can imagine, of course, that distributing and decentralizing a ledger will cause several problems. Because in the example where you were the only one maintaining the ledger, versus the example where everybody all across the world is maintaining the ledger, might cause a problem here and there. The valuable thing, of course, is reducing the three main risk categories, but you will always need to keep in mind, is it worth or is the additional inefficiency of distributing and decentralizing the ledger, is it worth reducing these three main risks? In other words, do I need a blockchain? As we will discuss further on, this is quite a famous question in the blockchain scene. So bottom line, the three main risk categories, the three main problems here with distributing and decentralizing a ledger are written on the wall, timing, ordering, and the third one, failure. So you need to keep in mind, a ledger's goal is just to represent the world as best as possible by recording transactions. So they want to mimic the real world as best as possible. To mimic the real world, of course, you need to set things A in a timely manner. That's the first thing you need to do. It needs to be timely, it needs to represent the world as best as possible, as we've seen in the perfect ledger. Also, the order of transactions need to be secured as well. It needs to have the same chronological order, and I will explain later on an example why that is important. And the third one, there's a huge problem when things are starting to fail, when nodes run out, for example, et cetera, right? It's the same risk as loss of records, in this case, when decentralized. Same goes, of course, with no coordinating party. People try to wiggle the system a bit into their advantage. They try to coerce or whatever, right? So three problems, and in the next slide, you will see an example of this. So currently, we will take a example, for example, Twitter, which is a centralized but distributed ledger, because the Twitter nodes or the Google nodes or WhatsApp nodes, whatever, the nodes are spread across the globe, right? But it's still centralized. Twitter determines this transaction is valid, this transaction isn't valid, you are able to join, you're not able to join. Twitter regards the content. The same as the banking system guard their content, WhatsApp filters it, etc., right? So we have a trusted third party coordinating this distributed ledger. So imagine a world where Twitter isn't there. So imagine a Twitter feed with no chronological order, or a WhatsApp conversation where a group WhatsApp where other people in the group see an other sequence of chat than you. It's undoable, right? It needs to be set in a timely manner. The same thing goes for banking transaction. So imagine this one. Let's say that I, for example, so imagine this, right? I have a 200 euro bill. To be sure, it's of plastic and it's a fifth the size of the real one. And it even says play money on it. So just to be sure. Bottom line here is that if a node wants to know if a transaction is valid, they need to be sure that I actually own this money. So if the past is differently according to their ledger than to somebody else's ledgers, this can give a certain problem. So let's say, for example, if I have this 200 euros and I will send it towards Africa, and the person in Africa will send it towards Russia. If somebody else picks up the transaction first from Africa to Russia, but never saw my transaction of 200 euro towards Africa, they will never know that that is a valid transaction because they don't have the same ordering. So you need to have your order fixed to follow the money through the ledger. You need to follow this money through the system, right? And that's basically how Bitcoin works, because Bitcoin is one of the most famous examples of a open, public, decentralized, distributed ledger, a blockchain. And they will just follow this money all across the globe. So basically, I own it now, I have to transfer it to somebody else. And all the other beavers around the world continuously keep updating their ledger and keep updating their ledger and eventually reach consensus, where consensus means who owns what in case of money. Right? So ordering, timing, and of course failure. The timing means not all nodes, not all the beavers work equally fast. So you need to have the same pace. In other words, if I'm chatting, I want to have the same information as somebody across the globe. If I'm sending money, I want the same status, who owns what. I need to know for sure that that person actually still has the money, or whether he already passed it along to somebody else. I need to have the same timely information. And failure is also a very sneaky one, because people will try to cook the books. They will try to send money in 20 folds, send it to the America, to Germany, to England, the same amount, of course. And then tell that ledger, hey, I send it to America, and tell that ledger, hey, I send it to Russia, right? So you shouldn't be allowed to cook these books. This last problem is also known as the double spending problem, because I double spent this money. And it is also known as the combination of these three factors is also known as the Byzantine general problem. So before we will start next session, where we will actually start explaining this Byzantine general problem, you just need to know that decentralized distributed ledgers don't use a trusted third party. The ledger itself gives trust, the consensus protocol. And more importantly, is that by removing the trusted third party, you decrease efficiency. So it becomes more inefficient, because it takes more time, more people, more power, etc., to record transactions. But the benefits are that you don't have the three main risk categories: loss of records, dishonesty, and exclusion.